Stanford University.
Of course, this is the Global Climate and Energy Project, and like many people, I was first drawn to the issue of gas because of its relatively small environmental footprint. It's especially true with respect to CO2, and if we're considering generating electricity with combined cycle coal plants, there's far less CO2 per unit of electrical output than coal, and across the board, methane is a much, much cleaner fuel than its alternatives. As I got more enthusiastic about this and began researching it, I put an article together for the issue of Earth. Earth is the publication of the American Geological Institute, sort of an institute of institutes. I think there's 60 member organizations or more, and basically laid out some of these fundamentals because the numbers for both technically recoverable and economically recoverable shale gas were growing exponentially. And if this were in fact true, then the utilization of natural gas, not only for replacing coal as for electrical generation, but also in transportation as the perfect sort of supplement to solar and wind. They're efficient, they're relatively clean, they're fast startup. Just natural gas seemed to have an awful lot going for it. And if it's coupled with sort of an enormous supply, then it's something that we need to start taking seriously. So the numbers keep changing. They keep going up. There are a few, New York Times every now and then publishes something about, well, are gas resources really, really big or really, really, really big? How many reallys do we put in there? And that'll be determined over time. But they're incredible. In North America alone, there's something like 35 or so active plays. And we currently use about 23 TCF, trillion cubic feet of gas per year, and the current estimate is that the US, North America has about 2,300 TCF or 100 year supply, 85% of which are shale gas resources. Globally, the numbers also are incredibly large. 22,600 TCF, the areas in gray were actually not even analyzed in this recent study, also from the Department of Energy. But there's something like 160 years of natural gas. And because so many areas weren't covered and so much of the world, the information available for so much of the world was sort of relatively incomplete, we keep being surprises. And in the last couple months, a major resource was disclosed in eastern India, a country that uses a lot of coal for electricity, as well as a huge reassessment of the available gas in England. And the publicity surrounding natural gas has been widespread in the last year, in this cover of Time, I think last July or so. This rock could power the world. I brought one of these rocks. This is a core of the Haynesville Shale from northern Louisiana. I'm going to pass it around. If it seems like a piece of plastic and not actually a rock, you're not unobservant. It's the fact that the permeability, the ability for fluids to flow through this rock, is a million times smaller than a conventional oil and gas reservoir. These rocks have permeabilities on the order of 1 to 200 nanodarcies. Conventional oil and gas reservoirs have permeabilities a couple hundred millidarcies. So these are extremely impermeable rocks, and the gas has been trapped. In this case, this rock is 150 million years old. So if you pass that around, and then I need the sample back. My students have only loaned it to me. Now, the shale gas revolution, whatever you want to call it, really started in Texas in the Barnett Shale, in the Fort Worth Basin. And this plot here, and even if you can't see the numbers, the shape of the curve tells you everything you need to know. The Barnett Shale, in around 2000, began to really take off. And by 2009, 2010, there were about 15,000 wells, about 1.75 TCF of gas were being produced. It was as a result of technological breakthroughs. The technological breakthroughs were, a lot of inspiration, but a lot of perspiration and a lot of trial and error. And basically, vertical wells were drilled and hydraulically fractured. Then as the ability to drill horizontally came along, horizontal wells were drilled, and they were drilled in the direction of the maximum horizontal stress, and when they were hydraulically fractured, hydraulic fracture started on the top and the bottom of the well. And then it was realized that if you drilled in the opposite direction, if you drilled in the direction of the minimum horizontal stress, you could do multi-stage hydraulic fracturing. In other words, you can fracture the well many times, as shown in this cartoon. So basically, that's how the wells are drilled and completed. You drill a vertical well. In the case of the Barnett, there tends to be about 7,000 feet deep. You drill horizontally within the shale, typically about 5,000 feet. And then you isolate sections of the well, and you carry out these hydraulic fractures sequentially. Now, another aspect of shale gas development that is not fully appreciated is that the way in which hydraulic fracturing is done is completely different than the way hydraulic fracture has been done roughly since the late 1940s. Yes?
Just a quick question on distances there. 7,000 down, 5,000 across, and what would the length of the green or the red or the blue be?
Well, I'll show you some data. We use the location of these microearthquakes I was just about to describe, but this tends to be several thousand feet in extent this way, and a few hundred feet, the thickness of the shale, this way. But I'll show you some more details. So this is obviously just a cartoon. And the number of fractures, the spacing, how they're treated, are things that vary from place to place and from operator to operator. What I was saying was that the original use of hydraulic fracturing was in low permeability reservoirs. And the idea was if you could propagate a hydraulic fracture, let's just say you have a conventional low permeability sandstone. Well, if the fluid has to flow out of that sandstone into the circumference of a single well, that's not very much surface area, and it's really hard to get large quantities of fluid out. So if you created this fracture plane and you propped it full of sand, you now have a lot of surface area for fluid to flow out of this low permeability rock into the fracture and then into the well. So these fractures were made with viscous gels. Large quantities of sand were injected. And these gels were designed so that after being very viscous during the time they're injected, so they can carry this sand a long, long way, that the temperature, as they heated up in the earth, the gels would break down, the viscosity would drop, and you'd just produce them out of the well, and then you're left with this prop fracture. So that's how hydraulic fracturing had been done roughly. The evolution of hydraulic fracturing, say, from 1950 to 2000 and 2005, somewhere in this time period here. And the story is that George Mitchell, the father of the Barnett, just got tired of paying the hydrofrac companies for all that gel. And so whether it's a true story, and I have no idea if the story is true, but I've heard it, and it's a great story, so let's use it. He said, just pump water. Just pump water and see what happens. So now frac fluid is 99.5% water and sand. There's a little bit of thickening agent. Basically, it's what's used in ice cream to thicken ice cream. There's a biocide that's added and a little bit of a friction reducer. And what's really key is not the fact that the fluid is cheap and easy. It's that the physics is different. And what happens with slick water fracking is that the hydrofrac becomes a conduit for water. And the water then is exposed to the formation over this large area. The water bleeds off into the shale. And as the water penetrates the pre-existing fractures, what happens is it causes slip on pre-existing faults. And that's what these little microseismic events are. And so what's happening during slick water fracking is that the fracking process is changing the permeability of the shale. And because of that, because we you know, we're not trying to produce out of a 100 nanodarcy matrix perm anymore. We're able to stimulate the reservoir and actually get the gas out. Now, we don't fully understand how this happens, and that's what I'll be describing more in a few minutes.
What is the effective increase in
perm? You know, I'm going to show some decline curve analysis and some other things that begin to answer that question. A little bit about economics. This is from the National Academy of Science study, America Energy's Future, that was published in 2009. And they pointed out that if you compare, say, natural gas to coal for generating electricity, you know, with or without carbon capture and sequestration, and they used a high price for natural gas and a low price of natural gas, because traditionally natural gas prices have been very volatile. The important point is that the low price for natural gas, which it was $6 per 1,000 cubic feet, $6 per MCF, natural gas beats coal with or without carbon capture and sequestration. And, you know, which is kind of interesting, because when we look at the prices, this is a slide that was made by Morgan Stanley for Anadarko. And the question, of course, is at what price can companies like Anadarko go out and commercially drill, complete these wells, and produce natural gas and still make a profit? And the point of the slide was to show, you know, for the 35 or so active shale plays in North America, at 2007-2008 prices, up around $7 a 1,000 cubic feet, almost all of these plays were economical. At $4 an MCF, which was true in March when this slide was made and is true today, the gas price is just about where that red line is, only about half of them, or less than half of them, are economic, and some are pretty marginal. So there's a real challenge of $4 gas. So it's even a better deal for the utilities, of course, but if companies can't afford to produce it and make a profit at $4, well, then it's they're not going to do it. And so there's that first order economic challenge. But there's another challenge, and that is that every day companies are competing with this price, which means that they're trying to reduce the costs of drilling and completion as much as possible, much to the potential detriment of the environment. And I want to talk about the environmental impact of all this at the end of my talk, because well construction, appropriate well construction, is the most important thing that can be done. And yet, you know, they've got to save as much money during drilling and completion as possible in order to operate at these low gas prices. And for most of the companies, not for the biggest companies have plenty of resources, but for most of the companies in this business, at this very low price, they collect as little data as possible. There's no longer the explore, discover, produce model of the oil and gas industry. This is a resource play. Everybody knows where this shale is. Now, there are better parts and there are worse parts of the shale. There's all sorts of details that are really important. But you know where the shale is. And for this reason, a lot of companies go into kind of a factory mode in which they look at a map and they lay out the wells based on their acreage, and they decide, well, the last time we used 15 fracs per well, it worked out pretty well, and we used this kind of pumping and this kind of sand, and they just go, and they're basically producing this blindly, when in fact, they're drilling more wells, they're doing more fracs, they're spending more money than they have to. But it's an easier way for them to operate because they can predict all their costs and try to get them down and operate. So the low price of natural gas is really a major problem. The way to solve the problem, since there's so much natural gas, is to increase the number of markets. It's LNG, and you know, we're now, just a few years ago, we thought we'd be importing natural gas. The DOE has just approved the first, you know, everybody's turning the valves around because now the first plant, I think it's in Texas, is going to be exporting natural gas. The Canadians are getting ready to do it, and so on. Using more gas for electricity, using more gas for transportation. As the markets for gas improve, the price will improve, and that's going to be good for everybody. So I've been involved in a DOE study on the environmental impact of natural gas development. I was just in Washington yesterday talking about this. We've issued a 90-day report that's available online. I'm going to talk about these environmental impacts at the end of the story. But what I've mostly been concerned as a university professor is when we look at the size of this of these operations, over the next 5 to 10 years, 100,000 wells are going to be drilled. 1 to 2 million hydrofracs are going to be done. And the question, you know, we're trying to answer is how do we optimize this development? How do we do this in the way that gets the most gas out with the fewest wells, the fewest hydrofracs? And to do this, we need to better understand the reservoir. And that's what I really want to talk about during most of this morning. And we want to minimize the environmental impact. You know, there was a period where at least every week there was a story in the New York Times or elsewhere about some supposed environmental catastrophe accompanying shale gas development. There are hundreds of companies involved, thousands of wells being drilled, and there have been real problems. But a lot of those problems have been mischaracterized, and if you mischaracterize the problem, you mischaracterize the solution. And that's what our committee has been trying to address. So we want to come back to this and talk about, you know, this in more detail. We understand what's happening in this kind of heuristic way. We drill, we carry out these multiple hydrofracs, we generate these micro earthquakes, and we can produce commercial quantities of natural gas. But we have to go beyond that if we really want to optimize this resource and know that we're doing the right thing. And I like to show this this survey. It's getting a little old now. This was done in 2009. It was at SPE, Society of Petroleum Engineers Forum on Shale Gas. It was held in Arlington, Texas. So this is the Fort Worth Basin. This is the Barnett Shale. And the meeting wasn't only about the Barnett, but it was dominated by the Barnett. And these are the engineers who were working on this every single day. And during this sort of standard conference, we've all been to many of them, somebody had the idea of asking just some informal questions. And they wrote out questions, they passed them out, and they said, you know, you don't sign your name, just answer the questions, drop your ballot in the back of the room at the end. And then they were compiled. So here are the industry experts who at this time, when gas was $7 or $8 an MCF, were drilling, fracking, and completing as fast as they could. It was like an old-fashioned land rush. They couldn't go fast enough. And yet, when asked the question, I'm confident that I understand reservoir drainage, 80% of the respondents said, no, I'm not confident. I am confident in our estimated ultimate recovery number. EUR, of course, is going to dictate the economics of the play. Am I confident? 80% said no. Everybody's doing the same thing, drilling, fracking, and more, you know, 90% of what goes on from project to project is identical. I think new completion technology is needed. 85% said yes. I think new drilling technology is needed. 70% or so said yes. So I attended this conference with a student. We were, you know, just starting to work in this area, and I realized, you know, this is an opportunity. When the experts working in the field candidly admit that they need help in all of these absolutely critical areas, that was something my students and I could contribute to. So the research themes that we're working on as we move from 101 into sort of the graduate level of shale gas development, you know, what factors actually control the success of this slick water fracking process? In other words, how does the stress, the forces in the earth, the fractures that are pre-existing, the rock properties, these shales are complicated materials, how do they affect the success of stimulation? How do the pressure and stress evolve during stimulation? We're pumping a tremendous amount of water into this formation, hundreds of thousands of gallons in each stage of the frack. They are, we have direct evidence that the formation is changing as this happens. How does it happen? What factors affect the seismic, the microseismic events, and aseismic deformation mechanisms, and how do these affect the reservoir? As I'll show you in a minute, in addition to what happens microseismically, these tiny little earthquakes that go off, I think there's a lot of aseismic, slow slip-on faults, which is really what's going on inside the reservoir. And in fact, the slow slip, what we don't observe microseismically, is maybe far, far more important than the microseismic events. And ultimately, how can we model this evolution, right? What's happening to the reservoir, and how does it change? That's really going to tell us what the stimulated volume is, and it's going to tell us how much gas eventually we're going to get out. In other words, all of this are related to the question, how do we optimize this process? This is my research group. Most of the work I'll be talking about here in a minute have been done by these students. There's some work done by a student that's graduated. There's another student in the ERE department whom I'm working with, who's not shown here, but they're a fine crowd. And we do this work in close collaboration with private industry. These reservoirs are complicated, and we need to work closely with the companies to get core samples, to get data, to do reservoir simulation. All of these different projects are very multifaceted, and we can work on a part of it, but to understand the part that we're working on, we really need to work closely with these companies. So that was all sort of preamble, and so I want to talk a little bit about microseismicity and reservoir stimulation. I want to talk about the physical and chemical properties of these shales. I want to talk about this issue of reservoir drainage and estimating ultimate recovery. That's the ultimate economic driver. I want to talk about this issue of aseismic fault slip that I mentioned being so important in reservoir stimulation. I want to mention one of the problems that have arisen recently, and that is the triggering of larger earthquakes during the shale gas development. What happens is after you do all this hydraulic fracturing and bring the well online, you produce back a fraction of the injected water. In some parts of the country, very little water comes back. In other parts of the country, between 25 and 50% of the water comes back. What do you do with it? The water you inject is relatively benign. The water that comes back is not. It's picking up all sorts of things in the shale. It's picking up brine. They come back very saline. They come back with metals, and they come back with other contaminants, and it has to be dealt with. And finally, I'll talk about our report on minimizing environmental impact. So this is real data. This is from ConocoPhillips, Barnett Shale. 5 wells that were drilled. Each well was fracked 10 times, starting at, so this is the vertical section of the well, and the wells kick off horizontally, okay? The direction of minimum stress is like this, so the hydrofracs are expected to propagate from left to right. The different dots represent microearthquakes recorded during different fracturing stages. And what's typically done then is you draw sort of an envelope around the microearthquakes, and you describe that as your stimulated rock volume. That's the volume of rock which you have affected and from which you will eventually be producing natural gas. Well, that's a very poor definition of the volume of rock affected, because the more uncertain your microearthquake locations are, the better job you seem to have done in stimulating the rock volume, the more scatter in these events. So this is something, how to estimate the stimulated rock volume is an important question. Yes?
How are they recording their micro earthquakes? Are they using geophones setups?
Yeah. The question, and I have to, for these clarification questions, I've got to repeat them for the video. There'll be a microphone later on. The answer to the question of how they're recorded is you have to use downhole geophones. And in this particular experiment, what they were experimenting with was how to do the fracking. And so in the middle well, which we just call well C, there was an array of geophones, 3-component geophones, And these geophones started up near the toe of the well, and then in these first two wells, they were simulfracked. The first set of perfs were hydrofracked simultaneously in both wells. Then they isolate this and do the second stage, they isolate that, do the third stage, and so on. And then the monitoring array was moved in this well, always to stay as close as possible to these microearthquakes. I should say that these microearthquakes are typically magnitude minus 2. And to give you a sense of a minus 2 earthquake, it's the same amount of energy as a gallon of milk falling off a kitchen counter. That's not very much energy, right? The patch size is less than a meter. The amount of slip is about a tenth of a millimeter, the thickness of a human hair. So these are very, very small events. And you have to be downhole to record them. Then what they did over here is they did what was called zipper fracking. They fracked this, then fracked that, fracked this, then fracked that. The advantage here is they had to have twice as many pumps and all the surface equipment on, because every group of perfs were being hit with the exact same amount of fluid over a given period of time. And then finally, they pulled the array out of the middle well, put it in a vertical section of one of the wells, and then fracked this from the toe to the heel sequentially, one stage at a time. And they were trying to compare the effectiveness of these different fracking styles against the final amount of gas that was produced. This shows you kind of the kind of data that are collected. So this is the pressure during the frack job, both at the surface and downhole. This is the proppant that was being added, the sand that was being injected. And for some reason, there was a little hiccup in the middle, and they stopped injecting sand for a moment and then resumed, and the rate changed. But anyway, over about a two-hour period, 325,000 gallons of water and 400,000 pounds of sand were injected. And one nice thing about this experiment is that that was true of almost every stage, so they could compare and contrast these things. Now, if you look at this diagram, you can almost tell visually that the distribution of earthquakes microearthquakes is very uneven and generally increase from the toe of the wells back toward the heels. There are many more earthquakes back here. And remember, each stage was pumped exactly the same way. And if the microearthquakes are key to the stimulation, and the stimulation is key to getting the gas out, we really want to understand why that is. And I'm not going to have time to go into this in any detail. We've written it up. This is the number of earthquakes above what we think is the detection threshold. We think we're detecting all of the earthquakes minus 2.5 and larger. And whether we're looking at the simulfracks, the conventional single frack, or the zipper frack, the slope of the line is always upward. In other words, as we go from the toe to the heel with these various frack stages, we always get more earthquakes. Why is that? Well, as I said earlier, one of the real problems we're having is that operators are collecting very little data. But we were very lucky in this case because the middle well does have data. It had a very nice set of logs, geophysical measurements made along the length. It had a very nice image log, a formation microimager from Schlumberger, which could be used to study the distribution and orientation of pre-existing faults. And so this shows the frack stages from the toe to the heel. This shows the number of fractures. So you can see back here towards stages 7, 8, and 9, there are far more fractures. And the number of earthquakes when this well was eventually fractured increased, and there were more, back where there's more fractures. This is the gamma ray log, which is generally an indication of how much clay is in the rock. There's more clay in the rock near the toe, and this than near the heel, and this could be very important. These are rose diagrams. I don't think you can see the circle, but the histogram, the circular histogram, shows the orientation of these fractures. And as you back here in this stage 7, 8, 9 area that we're interested in, the fractures are striking almost east-west, just slightly south of east. This is going to be important later on. Now, this ICIP, the instantaneous shut-in pressure, tells us what the force in the earth is that's trying to close the fracture. Or conversely, the pressure needed to open the fracture. And in this well C, every single stage back here from the first to about the eighth or the ninth showed us an increase in that force. And that's a direct response of the formation. It's a poroelastic response to all of the fluid that we're pumping in. And the reservoir is, in fact, responding to the frac job, and that, of course, so when we, you know, when we do this stage, it's not the same reservoir that it was previously. So the gamma ray is telling us that there's variations in the amount of clay. The FMI is telling us there's variations in the amount of the fractures and the pre-existing fractures and the faults. And the pumping pressures here are showing us that the pore pressure and the stress are evolving as we go. So we have a lot of variables that we're trying to sort out to understand why the reservoir responds differently. And we're trying to do that through sort of coupled poroelastic modeling to see if we can actually explain that. And that's actually where the research is right now. And the poroelastic modeling we've done, the coupled modeling we've done to date, can replicate what we see qualitatively, but we've not yet successfully modeled that kind of this kind of response. But we're working on it. And that's a really important thing because, you know, we ask the question, what is the stimulated rock volume? And the stimulated rock volume is, it's going to be the modeling that tells us what the stimulated rock volume is, not where the micro earthquakes are. Let's talk about the physical and chemical properties of these shales. Now, I passed around that sample. Its matrix perm is a couple hundred nanodarcies. That's something that all of these 35 plays have in common. Extremely low matrix perm. But in every other way, they're all slightly different. Most of these shales aren't even shales. If you look up a shale in a geologic dictionary, you'd find that these rocks would be called silty mudstones. They don't have as much clay as a true shale should have. They have different, they're found at different depths, different levels of cement, different kinds, and diagenesis, the cementation is different, the amount of carbon, you know, organic material is different, and the maturation of those organics is different. There's a lot of differences. What we're trying to do is look at some of the physical properties and how those physical properties affect this. Is this a change from being clay-rich and more sort of ductile to low clay and more brittle, as we saw, for example, in the gamma log and as we saw in the FMI, very few fractures here and lots of fractures in the more brittle rock back here. So working with our industrial partners, we have samples of the Barnett Shale, which we classify as light and dark, basically to indicate various amounts of clay. Haynesville, light and dark, again, distinguished by the amount of clay. So the sample that I passed around is something like 20-25% clay. Fort St. John is a shale from Canada that we've done a little bit of work with. We have the Eagleford from South Texas. And we know the general properties of the Eagleford, but the analysis of the samples that we've been working on is still being studied. We have Horn River, a huge play in Canada, samples coming. And we've been promised samples from the Marcellus Shale, the big play extending from Ohio, West Virginia, Pennsylvania, and into southern New York. So we see some fairly interesting and obvious things. This is the strength of the rock, and it's decreasing with clay content. This is Young's modulus, the stiffness of the rock, and it's decreasing with clay content. So the more clay is in the rock, the weaker it is. The more clay is in the rock, the more compliant it is. And these are bedded rocks, so that their rocks are stiffer parallel to the bedding than they are perpendicular to the bedding. So they're intrinsically anisotropic. But the property of the rocks I want to talk about the most is their viscous properties, because these rocks will flow or creep. And so if you apply a load to the rock, you'll see an instantaneous elastic response. And then if you hold that load as a function of time, as shown here in this cartoon, the rock will continue to deform. Okay, so this is called creep or viscoplasticity. The reason viscoplasticity is important is because our shale development process is based on the brittleness or the stiffness or the elastic properties of the rock. We need differential stress to propagate our hydraulic fracture, and we need to make microearthquakes. We need to cause active slip-on faults. And you can imagine if the rock were more like modeling clay than like a hard rock, well, it won't hold very much stress, or a rock that's very viscous, if you apply a strain, the stress will just relax out of it, and it will not break brittlely. So the viscoplastic or creep properties of these shales is very important. And as we look at these shales, what we see is, this is what we call Barnett light, very little clay, very little creep. This is creep after 3 hours. As we add more clay, or look at samples with more clay, there's a bit more creep. But when we look at samples with as much as 39% clay, there's quite a bit of creep. This is the Haynesville from Louisiana. And of course, the more clay there is, the more viscous the rock is going to be and less prone to stimulation through slick water fracking. And so this is sort of the same data shown another way, the axial creep as amount of clay content, whether we're normal to the bedding or parallel to the bedding. So just like with the elastic moduli, the structure of the rock that makes the rock anisotropic makes it creep in an anisotropic way. And if we push it perpendicular to the beddings, it flows much more than if we push it parallel to the bedding. And you'll see why in a minute. And this shows the axial strain as a function of Young's modulus. So what's after 3 hours, and what's absolutely clear then is Young's modulus is a elastic parameter that can be determined or estimated seismically before we drill or by making geophysical measurements once we've drilled. And now we can correlate this kind of this tendency for or how frack-friendly a given part of the reservoir is going to be to something we can measure geophysically in advance of drilling. This is one of my students, Arjun Kohli, using the SEM over in the engineering facility. And you can see the bedding on this. This is an Eagleford sample. You can see the bedding like this. And when you look really closely, you can see the clays that are all stacked up. This is a natural fracture in the plane of the bedding, but it's probably been exacerbated by both exhumation and preparation of the sample. So there aren't big gaping holes in the sample like this. I'll show you some pore structure a little bit later. But once you look at this fine structure, it's not a surprise anymore that when you push on it this way, it's going to be a lot more compliant than if you push parallel to those clay platelets. Now, there's an interesting region on this map called the Floyd Shale, which you see here in Alabama and Mississippi. And the Floyd Shale has always interested me, although there's very little information available about it. And the reason there's little information is because a few wells were drilled. The shale is there. The shale seems to have, you know, all the normal properties, but they were not able to stimulate production in the Floyd, and basically companies gave up on it. Now, if you look at the Floyd Shale over here, its depth is not 6,000 to 13,000 feet, is not so atypical. The organic content, the maturation, the porosity, everything is about the same except for the clay content. And it's got far more clay than any of the formations from which gas is being produced. And frankly, what I think is going on is if this is what 39% clay does, you know, what does a rock with 50 or even 60% clay do? How creepy is it? Or as we measure the creep, what does this mean about stress relaxation? So one of my students, Hiroki Sone, and I have been trying to build some mathematical models to explain this. That's not important. But as we look at our various samples and we try to compare and contrast in a quantitative way how the normal deformation of the interior of the Earth, which is occurring you know, we're taking 150 million years. So, see, the great thing about being a tenured professor is you can do experiments over periods of 2 weeks, and you can extrapolate over 150 million years, and they can't fire me. Okay. I call these quantitative calculations and a qualitative result. Basically, we predict that for these very creepy, very low viscosity samples of Haynesville shale, we could only support about a megapascal, 150 psi of differential stress. Whereas for these samples with much less clay, these low clay Barnetts, you could get about 10 times as much. Those numbers are actually about right. But we're ignoring burial, we're ignoring diagenesis, we're ignoring thermal effects, we ignore all sorts of things. So I really think it's a qualitative result, but I think we're beginning to see, you know, why these rocks behave differently. And what it's saying is these high clay rocks, all other things being equal, may make the rocks, you know, so capable of just relaxing the stress and deforming ductally that they may not be amenable to development. Now, one thing we don't understand very well, as we'll just, if you want to keep a scorecard, another thing we don't understand very well is basically the flow mechanisms that take the gas, you know, from the rock, you know, to the well. And to illustrate that, we'll look at some more of these SEM photographs, and this lens is a piece of kerogen, organic material, that's in the shale. These little flat areas are just an artifact of how the sample was prepared. But the bedding is going from left to right, as in that other sample, and that's a piece of kerogen. As we zoom in, you can start to see some structure within the kerogen. And when you zoom in some more, you can actually see the pores. And those are the pores where the gas resides. Okay. And that's 500 nanometers. So these pores are about 100 nanometers across. And those are typical sizes. So that's where the gas originates. And that's the initial pore size through which the gas must flow. Okay? And somehow, it's got to get from that, those tiny pores, out of the rock. And this is what we really don't understand. And it's absolutely clear, you know, key to the fundamentals of the economics of this play. So let's take it from the other side. Okay, we'll talk about scaling up from the pores. Let's scale down. This is what the production of the wells actually look like. Valco and Lee are two petroleum engineers at Texas A&M. And what they've done here is they've taken monthly averages for the Barnett Shale. So the wells from well to well vary quite a bit. And so they've just averaged all of the wells drilled in July of 2005. And then they've averaged all the wells drilled in July of 2006. And the, this would be July of 2004, July of 2005, and July of 2006. Now, the first month is always contaminated by the fact that they're not actually producing for the entire month. So this data point is anomalously low. If it was normalized for a month, you know, that data point would be up there. So what you see is a rapid fall off in the production over a period of several years. Okay? This rapid fall off is very well explained by conventional petroleum engineering decline curve analysis using the kind of hyperbolic design, hyperbolic decay type equations that are standardly used and work well in normal petroleum reservoirs. But what does not work is the fact that the production is flattening off. And in fact, the purpose of this paper by Valco and Lee was to propose an extended exponential model that actually helps better explain why these wells don't just keep declining rapidly, but why they flatten off. And so the key question right now is, how flat is this, and how far into the future can we extend it? Because while the production rate is relatively low, a number of industry leaders are saying that these wells are going to last for 20 or 30 years. Okay, so we're going to take 1 year of production, and we're going to extend it 30 years. Maybe you can get fired for that. I don't know. But this is what the CEO of Chesapeake and Anadarko and other guys are out there, and they're having active discussions with the SEC about whether these kinds of extrapolations are reasonable and the value of their resource is in fact what it is claimed to be. And frankly, if we just don't, you know, this development has occurred so fast that we don't have much of an empirical database to rely on. We can't say, well, this is the way these shales have deformed, have produced. And therefore, we do have confidence, or, 10 years is okay, 20 years. We just don't know because it's just been too short a time. Yes?
So perhaps a clarification question. Have you done isotopic analysis on the methane coming off C14 to know if it's the same gas at the back end that it is at the front end? And I can wait until the end.
Okay. The short answer is, the question is whether it's the same gas coming out, and the answer is I don't know. And I don't know if anyone has done it. I hope they have, but I'm kind of leading to something related to that question right now.
Mark?
Yes.
Clarification question.
Yes.
What are the exponents that they're getting for the extended exponential model? Is it 0.3,
0.2? I'll send you the paper. I don't remember. Okay. So this leads to a question I've been posing as a justification for our research program for quite a while. So Here's one of these fracs, okay? Schematically, it's about 100 meters high, which is the thickness of the Barnett, about 300 feet. An individual frac, so you can imagine the well going through the middle of this, is about 1,000 feet, 300 meters long. We really don't know the thickness of the volume because of the uncertainty in the location, but it's got to be on the order of tens of meters because you've got to mine gas out of a volume to do the to account for what's produced. Only about 5%. There's 5% gas saturated porosity in these rocks, and so the key question is how do we go from this nanoscale pore network to some sort of pre-existing microcracks, which we don't know very much about these, to pre-existing macroscale fractures. These are the fractures and faults we might be able to see with an image log, to the induced shear events, to the slickwater frac plane, and then eventually to the well. Now, I said that these slickwater frac events bust up the rock and provide the ability for the for the gas to flow out. And something like that has to happen, but it's not clear how. An individual frac stage, like is shown here in cartoon form, produces about 100 or maybe 200, 100 of these microearthquakes. Well, a given microearthquake is less than a meter in size. So now we're going 300 meters this way, we're going 100 meters this way, we're going tens of meters at least this way, and we have a 100 of these less than a meter disks distributed through this volume. So these things aren't touching very much of the reservoir, they're not touching each other. It's certainly not clear how they're connecting up things because there's just so few of them. So not only are they small from an energetic point of view, really, really like a large firecracker, not only are they very small, they're so widely distributed that it doesn't seem like they can be connecting up the reservoir very, very efficiently. I like to describe this, that if you really know a lot about this, you can prove that it's impossible to produce gas out of these rocks. Okay. Yeah, Mark Twain said that much better than I did. So here's what I think is going on, although in general, and this is from Carl Sondergeld at the University of Oklahoma. I don't agree with all of this, but I think Carl's on the right path. And what he's pointing out is that we have normal Darcy flow, standard flow in which the flow rate is proportional to the pressure gradient in the rocks as dictated by the permeability of the rock and the viscosity of the fluid. Darcy, we know a lot about Darcy flow. But as we get to these smaller pore sizes, we no longer have Darcy flow, and we eventually get back to processes where diffusion is important and where adsorption and desorption processes are important. And so we're trying to understand, and I'm currently working with Jen Wilcox, who's I think speaking this afternoon, and Tony Kovchek, both in the ERE department, to try to look at these flow mechanisms at multiple scales and to try to understand whether it's changing the flow regime or looking at processes such as desorption that's accounting for the long tail on the curve. That, in other words, the initial production is dominated by the easy porosity, the larger fractures that are close to the well, and then as time goes on, we're accessing more and more low permeability material, but that's where the gas is, and maybe it's perfectly justifiable that these things are going to stay flat for decades to come. This is work that my former PhD student, John Vermillen, did, combined with information from the literature, and he's showing, you know, how much methane is adsorbed in the Barnett Shale as a function of pressure. So these are the adsorption isotherms. And, you know, if you actually do the calculation and you take that area and you desorb all of that methane as the pressure drops, you get this methane back, there's a lot of methane. But we don't know whether, in fact, you know, the pressure is dropping everywhere, how uniformly distributed that desorption process is, or whatever. But desorption could be very important. Now, it's not really important in plays like the Haynesville, where it's just too hot. The Haynesville is so hot that very little methane will be adsorbed. But it's kind of an anomaly. The other, you know, desorption could be very important in a number of the plays. We just don't know. Okay, so another thing we don't know. Okay, here's the one that I've been really interested in and working on with a couple of students, and that is how the microearthquakes are affecting production. The whole premise of this whole thing is we make these microearthquakes that change the permeability of the shale to get the gas out, but we don't really understand how that happens. So we've been using dynamic rupture modeling. This is work that Madhurjauri and I have been doing with Eric Dunham, another professor in the geophysics department, doing dynamic rupture modeling, the same thing that's being used to model big earthquakes on big faults, how it's being done, how it's occurring on a very small fault. And so we try to simulate these earthquakes. Now, we've done a variety of calculations in very different parameters. We know what the rock strength is. If we actually put in a realistic rock strength, almost nothing happens. We say, well, maybe this is, you know, everything's occurring in rock that's more broken up. So we actually go to the limit, and we throw away the cohesion of the rock, and we say, well, okay, that the area here is about a meter in each of these cases. And so, you know, okay, there are areas where we might be breaking up the rock near the ends of the rupture. And so what I did is I said, okay, well, let's assume that we have a 2-meter sphere in which the rock is completely pulverized. Now, that is a wild extrapolation of what the actual calculations show. So I've really taken the calculations to their limit. And I said, okay, let's assume that within that 2-meter sphere, the rock is completely pulverized, and we get every molecule of gas out. Now, the gas saturated porosity is about 5%. And we know that we have about 4,000 or so of these microearthquakes. So I multiply times 4,000, and I produce less than 1% of the gas that's produced in the first 6 months. Pardon?
From actual wells?
From these five wells. So something is not working. Somehow these very small microearthquakes by themselves, even if they completely pulverize the rock, it's not clear how they would connect to each other, but let's assume they are. It's not clear that they would allow you to mine all the gas out, but let's assume that it is happening. The mass balance just doesn't work. So what else is going on? And that's why I want to talk about aseismic fault slip. So watching what my colleagues in earthquake seismology have been doing, I got very interested in the question about whether or not there was something going on during all this pumping other than these tiny little microearthquakes. And my student Indrajit Das and I published a paper in The Leading Edge, which is published by the Society of Exploration Geophysicists in July. These are spectrograms, so it's the spectra of a seismogram as a function of time. And the spikes that you see here, from 0 to 500 hertz, those are microearthquakes. And if you examine one of those spikes and you expand the seismogram, there you see the nine components of the nine geophones, one of the three components. You take one of those and you look at the the three components, and you can see P waves and S waves. These are tiny little earthquakes as we know them, and they are then studied and analyzed as we analyze normal earthquakes. So we, you know, that's how the service companies analyze this data and determine the locations and magnitudes of all those little dots that I've been showing you. But we went looking for something else. So now we're going from 0 to 100 hertz, and we expand some of the data. And now you can see energy that is at much lower frequency, and it's persisting for much longer time periods. And after we bandpass the data, what we see are signals that look like this, kind of a rumbling that goes on for many tens of seconds. Here they're going on for about a minute, okay? And on, you know, that is completely missed during this microseismic analysis. Now, on the right side, I'm showing similar kind of data from different tectonic areas around the world. This is where the Juan de Fuca plate is subducting beneath North America. This is Taiwan. This is the deep San Andreas Fault, where in the past decade, it's been discovered that below the brittle and locked section of these faults, the faults that are at greater depth are actually slipping quasi-stably and episodically. And it's called episodic tremor and slip. So this is what's called tremor. And with sufficient GPS information, you can actually see that the faults are slipping while these seismic events are being recorded. And so these are being seen all over the world. They're really a really exciting discovery. Again, starting about a decade ago, my colleague Greg Barroza has been very involved in this research. But what it all boils down to is slow slip on faults occurring over large areas. And our argument is that, well, maybe that's what's occurring in the Barnett Shale as we stimulate it. And Mark and I have been extending it for the shale gas. So what we have here is a schematic based on these Barnett wells. There's our well. There's three fracs 150 feet apart. The orientation of all of these fractures, the distribution of orientations, is the distribution that we observed. The average spacing along the well is consistent with the spacing we observed. What we don't do, and I don't think we're doing it correctly here, and this is, you know, this is work in progress, but we're not modeling the lengths of the fractures properly. And I think most of these fractures are a bit too long, and we have some ideas about how to put that into the models more realistically. But nonetheless, a lot of the stress and the properties in the model are what we measure. So a lot of the model is constrained, but some important things are unconstrained, and that needs to be noted. So what Mark is going to do here in the calculation is he's going to simulate the fracking. So he's going to pump for 2 hours here, and then it takes about 10 hours for them to stop one job and start the other. And then after 2 hours of pumping here, move to this one. He's pumping, you know, 99.5% water and sand. And I've got to click it here. And so what you can see is the pressure changing in all of these subsidiary fractures as a function of time. And then they come over here, and this lights up. And then a little bit later, you'll see they're coming here. And what happens then is when the faults slip, it fundamentally changes their permeability. And this is part of something I don't have time to talk about, but there's a lot of evidence for this. So the slipping fault is almost like a prop fracture. So what you're effectively doing is you're increasing the area of contact with the reservoir, okay, and therefore enabling much better productivity than would be predicted from the microseismic events alone. And all of this slip is aseismic. You would not be hearing it. But you could have predicted it, because everything that went into this model was known before this well was drilled, and conceptually. I mean, of course, we're doing it years afterward. But conceptually would be known before this well was drilled, before the fractures were you know, designed and carried out, and you can see how poor the contact with the reservoir is in some places. You know, we're just leaving lots of places unexploited, but you know, it's pretty good in other places. And you might, you know, you might use these kinds of calculations to say, well, I should have put an extra frack in there, or maybe I shouldn't have even bothered with that one. You know, I mean, you know, we're not there yet, but you can see how this kind of modeling could really guide field operations. And these days, you know, half the cost of development is drilling and half the cost is fracking. And if you can drill fewer wells and if you can do fewer fracks, you can save a lot of money. Now, could any of this be known ahead of time? Maybe. So this is the part of the reservoir we're looking at. And we've got 3D seismic data. So here's a seismic cross-section through the area. This reflector is the top of the barnet. This reflector is the bottom of the barnet. And this is the amplitude of the reflection at the top of the barnet. And this big blotch here is an area of low reflectivity. So the stiffness of the barnet compared to the overburden, or the contrast, is much less than it is here. It's a much lower acoustic impedance here than in the surrounding areas. Okay? If we just look at this in sort of the absolute size of the signal as opposed to its sign, look at the RMS, it's over here, and this is where those aseismic events were coming from. And this work was done completely independently. We in fact, didn't even have the 3D seismic data until after our leading edge paper was being published. And so it's clear that there's something going on. Now, my first guess is that it's because there are more pre-existing fractures, it's more compliant. But certainly, if you can find spots that are more amenable to stimulation, you're going to be much better off. Maybe some of these wells wouldn't have been drilled, or some of the fracks wouldn't have been carried out in the less attractive parts. So this is something a lot of people are working on to try to have a predictive tool to identify the sweet spots of the reservoir as they're known. I want to talk about this managing triggered seismicity. It's a problem that first came to the public's attention in 2009 when a series of earthquakes started near Cleburne, Texas, basically on the Dallas-Fort Worth Airport. Once seismologists from University of Texas and SMU got involved and they put out a portable seismograph network, they could demonstrate that the earthquakes were in fact lining up along a known fault and occurring essentially adjacent to a saltwater disposal well. And when they stopped injecting, they stopped getting earthquakes. Now, the earthquakes, 2.2 to 3.3, if we actually look at what that means in terms of earthquake size versus fault size, you know, earthquakes on this size, you know, produce slip on faults that are hundreds of meters in extent, right? These earthquakes are barely detectable at the surface, you know, by people. I mean, here in the Bay Area, usually about magnitude 3 earthquake will be felt, okay? Anything smaller will not be. So they're very small earthquakes. A similar size earthquake occurred in Blackpool, England, which caused at least a temporary ban on hydraulic fracturing, which I think has been subsequently removed, but nonetheless. So these are very small earthquakes, but nonetheless, they are significant, and if people start feeling them, they become very significant. Now, the relationship between the forces in the earth and the faults that are likely to slip are very well known. And I want to show you this cartoon here for strike-slip faulting. Strike-slip faulting is when a slip occurs on a vertical fault and one side moves with respect to the other. So from sort of first principles, if the maximum stress is like this and a strike-slip fault occurs, the fault is expected to strike either 30 degrees from the maximum stress direction in this way or 30 degrees in that way. They're equally likely to occur. The earthquakes that really caused a lot of concern were earthquakes in Guy, Arkansas, again due to the injection of flowback water, okay, after hydraulic fracturing, in this case in the Fayetteville Shale. And in this case, the largest earthquake was a 4.7. The earthquakes line up like this. The injection well is right about there. They started when injection started. They kind of defined this trend. There was kind of earthquakes on sort of one end of the trend, earthquakes on the other end of the trend, and bang, along comes the 4.7 and fills in the gap. Now, this is a strike slip faulting area. This is a local stress map of the New Madrid seismic zone. We're kind of over here, a little bit to the left of this map, but we know the stress orientation very well. If we apply that stress orientation there and draw a line through the fault, it is exactly what elementary fault mechanics would predict would happen. So, you know, there is the potential for things like this to occur. And yet, you know, it's only a serious problem if it comes as a surprise and it's totally unmanaged. Because what we need to do is we need to characterize these areas to begin with, and you don't inject fluid next to an active fault. Good idea? Okay, thanks. You don't do it. And if you're not sure, you monitor the seismicity. So you try to avoid faults, you try to limit the pressure increases, and if something is happening, you simply need to be prepared to abandon some injection wells, okay? Again, even a 4.7, it caused a little bit of damage, not very much damage, but still, you don't want this thing going on, and it's actually going to cause damage to the wells, it could cause leakage, it could cause other things. The shaking is not the critical part. The public is the critical part. And you simply have to get out in front of this. Now, I also, you know, put an asterisk here and said, or injection intervals, because now there are reported cases. The case in England was the first that got widespread publicity. There's a recent newspaper article about similar earthquakes occurring during hydraulic fracturing in northern Alberta. And so, if you're in an area where there are active faults, you don't want to be injecting fluid and stimulating slip on those faults. But this is predictive. It's manageable. It's simply necessary to do the characterization first, to do the monitoring, and to have a protocol in place so that if this happens, then you will respond in the following way. And if the companies have that worked out with the regulators ahead of time, you know, it's dog bites man. There's no news story there. Because typically when things like this happen, you know, the companies deny everything. The responsible agencies, you know, they just go into a frenzy. They don't know what's going on. And the newspapers just love it, right? It's a chance to beat up on big oil. But, you know, it doesn't have to be that way. And it hopefully we'll see more attempts to kind of get out in front of this and do the right kind of characterization and the right kind of monitoring so that when it does happen, the problem will be managed in a way that's already sort of acknowledged with the regulators is the right way to deal with it. Let me just say a few words about environmental impacts, and then I want to leave time for questions. So I've been on a DOE committee. We've just released our 90-day report, August 18th. And it's available online from the DOE. As part of President Obama's blueprint for a secure energy future, he identified the importance of natural gas, and he charged Energy Secretary Chu with convening a committee to look at the question of how to develop these resources while protecting the environment. Now, even the question was more important than the answer. Because the president asked how to do this. He didn't ask whether we should do it. He didn't ask could we do it, how to do it. And while our charge is written here, you know, we were asked to develop within 6 months consensus recommended advice to the agencies on practices for shale gas extraction to ensure protection of public health and the environment. So we've issued our three-month report, and now we're in the process of preparing our final report. There's seven of us on the committee: John Deutsch, the former Assistant Secretary of Energy and Director of the CIA, is the chair. Steve Holdrich, Chairman of Petroleum Engineering from Texas A&M, is on the committee. Fred Krupp is the President of the Environmental Defense Fund. Katie McGinty is the former Secretary of Environmental Protection for the state of Pennsylvania. Sue Tierney is on the National Petroleum Council and has been both a state and a federal regulator. Dan Juergen is well known, the head of CEA, and recently has published another massive tome on the energy industry called The Quest, and I've been honored to be able to serve on this committee as well. I think rather than go into our recommendations and to leave time for questions, I thought maybe, because we made 20 recommendations that affect well construction, protection of water, protection of air, and minimizing impact on the community. But you know, the bottom line is that all nine of us, people with very diverse backgrounds, you know, recognize the extraordinary importance of these resources. You know, they now account for 30% of all of our natural gas, and natural gas accounts for 25% of all of our energy. So it's very big, and it's getting bigger. It has $1 billion, you know, Pennsylvania derived $1.1 billion of revenue. There are hundreds of thousands of jobs being created. And shale gas can be developed in an environmentally responsible way. And the public deserves to know this. And the purpose of our report was to indicate in 20 different ways how steps could be taken to better protect the public interest. So just to skip over this to allow time for questions, let me, you know, this rock could power the world, this rock will power the world, but we still have a lot of work to do. We don't know how to optimize the resource, and we have to do even more to protect the environment as we go forward. So I'll stop there. Thank you very much. So we have about 15 minutes for questions. There's a microphone around. Please.
I am Eric from Stanford. You just mentioned optimizing the resource. Is there recommendations that to slow down current production until the shale is understood in order to maximize the total production? Are the wells destroyed if they're fracked improperly or not optimized way?
You know, they're not destroyed, but one has to question whether it's wise to just go ahead and do all this. There's a lot of refracking going on and infill drilling and things like that. So it's really being driven by the economics. So I don't think it's in general, in anyone's best interest just to stop. But the $4 gas price has certainly put the brakes on. And in many places, the drilling is at a level to maintain the viability of the leases. You know, the leases require a certain amount of drilling. And as gas prices go up, there'll be more drilling. So it's kind of modulated by the profitability. But you know, everyone would be better off. I mean, you'd be drilling fewer wells, doing less fracturing, if you produced more gas from every well that you drilled. So it would be a good thing to better understand this and keep moving efficiency forward. Khaled.
Steve Stein. There's a lot of controversy these days about disclosure of the chemical components of the fracturing fluid. How significant do you feel this is? How important will it be to keep some of these formulations proprietary, or is this kind of a red herring?
I think it's a red herring, but I think it's something the public cares about deeply. And so our committee has recommended full disclosure of the fracturing fluids, full disclosure of the fluids that come back after fracturing, and full manifesting of the water from the time it is extracted to the time it is eventually disposed of. One of the things I didn't talk about is in the Marcellus, in the, you know, northeastern US, There are very few opportunities for injection of the flowback water. So basically, almost 95% of the water is being reused. And that's a really good thing for everybody. You use less water, you get rid of the disposal problem, and so there's some minor changes of the chemistry of the frac fluid to allow you to use saline fluid, but that's really the right thing to do, just to keep reusing the fluid. But we've tried to take this issue off the table. We said the company should disclose everything going in, disclose everything coming out, put it on available websites. And the fact that, you know, this exclusion of having to declare these chemicals was granted to industry, 6 or 8 years ago, I think has really been counterproductive. It's made people very paranoid about non-issues. One of the things I didn't get a chance to talk to about is these fractures aren't growing anywhere close to water supplies. When there is gas in aquifers, it's because wells are poorly constructed and there's leakage along, you know, the outside of the casing where the cement should be. And well construction is the key. It has nothing to do with hydraulic fracturing. By the way, our committee, four of us testified before the Senate Energy Committee yesterday. The session is online. If you go to the Senate Energy Committee, you can find that. And there are four of us sort of talking about different aspects of our report.
Yeah. Mark, do we
understand how this gas exists in the rock? Is it all installed or partially installed and partially free gas? And
a related question, I understand in some areas you also have condensate along with gas. Do we understand all that?
I don't understand about we. In some places, there's clearly both free gas and adsorbed gas. There's no question about it. And the Barnett is typical of that. And I think most of the plays, that's true. What's controversial is how much of the gas production to date has been due to desorption. And people disagree about that. Other plays, like the Haynesville, there's almost no adsorbed gas. The temperatures are just so high. So it's all got to be free gas. So that part we know. What I had meant to say is that this horizontal drilling and multi-stage fracking is turning out to be extremely important in low-quality oil reservoirs because it's the same issue. And so in the Bakken Shale in North Dakota, these technologies are being used to produce oil. In the Eagle Ford, there's because of the maturation window, in some places they're gas wells, in some places they're condensate wells, and you're producing liquids. Because of the huge disparity in gas versus liquids price, the amount of gas drilling is gone down, but the amount of drilling, you know, for these condensates and liquids has gone up. And you're finding a lot of activity in Colorado and the Niobrara, you know. Basically, every crappy oil reservoir that's ever been found is now back in play. One has to, okay, we couldn't produce it before, right? But we can produce it now. So this horizontal drilling and multi-stage fracking is going to be, globally, it's going to be, you know, much more widely used in all sorts of reservoirs, not just gas reservoirs.
I've been asked to say my name. I'm Dan Sean of Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute. There's been at least one study that has estimated that the climate change impact of natural gas extraction from shale is perhaps a bit larger than that from using coal because of the methane leakage that occurs in the process. I have two questions. The first is, do you have any comment on those estimates? And second, did this panel address the climate change impact of shale gas extraction?
Okay, with respect to the second question is there's a research and development set of recommendations, and getting better data on what is called fugitive gas emissions is absolutely critical. Now the question of whether the full life cycle is better or worse than coal is obviously a critically important question. Traditionally, we use numbers like natural gas produces half as much CO2. The people who came out with their study questioning that conclusion used unreasonably high numbers for the amount of fugitive gas. That is, as the wells are being put into production, as you're flowing back, there's so much gas coming out that they're arguing escapes to the atmosphere that because of the greenhouse warming potential of methane, it's actually counterproductive. They also used kind of extreme values for GWP for the methane and used a 20-year timeline. Everyone else who's looked at this issue has disagreed with this Cornell study. Everyone who's looked at it, whether you're talking about the Sierra Club, NETL, or recently there's a Deutsche Bank World Watch Institute who's looked at this. Everyone comes to the conclusion that the conventional wisdom is in fact about right. Natural gas is much better than coal for the climate over the long term. However, every one of these studies would greatly benefit from better data on fugitive emissions. And there's no question that the numbers used in the Cornell study were unreasonably large, but it's not a number we have very good handles on, and we need to do that better. You know, there are also studies that say that natural gas, if we switch tomorrow, would cause, you know, more global warming because we don't have the particulates going into the atmosphere that are cooling the climate, which would mean renewables are the worst thing we could possibly do. So, you know, how crazy do we want to be, right? But ultimately, it comes back to getting good data, and good models will be derived from good data, and we need better data. But I think that our study is a really an extreme and relatively unreliable analysis.
Is that highly dependent on the location and the number of observation wells? Well,
yeah. These earthquakes are so small that there's a big observational problem. You need to be in the subsurface to be monitoring, which means you need a well available to monitor them. You want the well as close as possible. Now, in our study, we reduced, without going into the detail, we determined that magnitude minus 2.5 was our detection threshold, and there are ways of doing this, and that we were, our data was complete above that magnitude level. But if that monitoring well had been further away, that might have been minus 2 or minus 1.5. Attempts to use surface seismometers have been generally unsuccessful. Now people are using seismometers buried, 300-400 feet, which is a lot better than the surface. There's all sorts of ways people are trying to get at this. But the observational constraints are really important and have a first-order effect on our ability to use microseismic data to kind of know generally what's going on.
Right now the modeling is kind of a spectator sport in the sense that, like a lot of these, you run the model, you have no experimental way to validate the inputs and the outputs. But there is a principle, a way that drill tests can do cores both before and during or after some time of production,
and then
to see how much of the gas was absorbed, whether or not it was actually produced from where the model said it was produced, what the time dependence of that is. I know these are commercial operations, so actually getting them to participate in scientific experiments is difficult. But what's the prognosis for being able to do that, and how useful do you think that would actually be in validating these models?
You're right there with kinds of research we're talking about, and actually we've talked to one company about, using tracers in the proppant and trying to then actually drill and core right through the stimulated volume and see what, what's happened and where things are. We've talked to another company about collecting a core under pressure and watching the gas flow out of that and whether we see the same kind of decline curve, right? And the idea of looking at isotopic changes would be a good idea as well. So that's kind of where the research is. OMB has zeroed out research for the next 5 years on natural gas because it benefits the oil and gas industry. That's like zeroing out research in medicine because it benefits the medical industry. But the oil industry has. In fundamental research, and that is a public good because the, you know, we need energy.
But right now, that's the
situation in Washington. So the company, some you know, the bigger companies are more motivated to do this. They have the resources, the knowledge base to interpret the results and to take advantage of what they find. But it's hard to do with public funds, not in a peer, you know, in an open and research environment. Well, what for the microphone is, yeah.
My name is John. You're a California doctor.
I wonder if can we study the
The abandonment of the wells?
Yes.
Well, well abandonment is an important issue. And in fact, a lot of these cases, like in Pennsylvania, where aquifers are supposedly contaminated by shale gas development, are known to have been contaminated aquifers before shale gas development because of old wells that were poorly abandoned.
Right.
And these long periods of time. So one of my pet themes during this, and it says very strongly in our recommendations, is that well construction, which of course is the first step toward eventual well abandonment, is absolutely critical. And you've got to put enough casing at enough depths, not only cement, but you have to test the cement, right? Turns out I'm also on a committee looking at the Deepwater Horizon accident, and these themes keep coming up over and over again. But if you construct the well properly, it'll last for decades, and then it will be in good shape to be properly abandoned. And all that's regulated now as part of the permit process. But it has to be done right. It has to be done by the companies and regulated right by the states.
Thank you.
One more question.
You choose.
I was just going to suggest that one place to look for data that exists over a long period of time, there are production curves, you know, production history of Devonian shale wells back 30 years, right? Fracked and unfracked.
Mm-hmm.
So it should be able to do that.
Right. No, that's a very good.
Okay, thank you very much. For more, please visit us at stanford.edu.